This week, we saw huge new updates to the Linux and Steam Deck world. With massive upgrades to KDE Plasma, Bazaar, and KetchyOS, Linux gaming has never looked stronger. So let's get into it, all of this and more, in today's Steam Deck and Linux Gaming News video. All right, first up, my favorite like pet project, Bazaar. Now, Bazaar has made it into Flathub, and I am freaking stoked for this. In case you missed it, Bazaar is one of the most disruptive and exciting things to happen to package management over the last few years. It allows you to manage your Flatpaks, namely the discovery process, installation, updating, and removal, with both ease and speed. But it's also a lot more than that, too. It's placing an emphasis on supporting developers through the inclusion of a support button. And this is huge for the Linux desktop ecosystem for one simple reason. If we want to have best-in-class applications, especially open-source ones, we're going to have to put our money where our mouth is. Sure, we can rely on enterprise money to solve enterprise issues that also happen to benefit desktop users, but that's not like a sustainable thing for the desktop. And the thing is, there are many FOSS developers who are upset, and it comes from a genuinely understandable place. These developers put in their time, their effort, and their talent into developing applications, and most of the time, all they receive for their effort is end users' support tickets and thankless requests for new updates, or worse, scorn for a slow pace of development. If we want a computing world that's worth living in, if we want a desktop that is worth our use, and apps worthy of our attention, we need to buckle down and support the apps that we not only use, but rely on. That's why I'm so excited about Bazaar and why its availability on Flathub is so important. Because this is no longer just a Bazite application, this is now available on basically every Linux desktop. Hopefully it becomes the default in more distros and produces the intended result. And hopefully things can be changed and updated to encourage more people to support indie and open source developers. So you can search for Bazaar in Discover or GNOME Software, or if you're unsure, you can use the link in the description to flathub.org and click the install button. Then in Bazaar, you can actually search for your favorite games or apps and manage them right in this application. I'm so excited about this, guys. Definitely give it a try and let me know what you think in the comments. But before I move on, I want to take a moment and tell you guys about RackNerd. Now, ever since my previous hosting company was acquired by a massive conglomerate, I've been looking for a replacement that actually cares about Linux users. And I've got to say that I have found it with RackNerd. They have professional-grade VPS hosting at shockingly affordable prices. Not only that, they're beating my previous host with higher specs and more bandwidth at a lower price point. If you'd like to help out this show and discover why RackNerd has become my hosting provider of choice, you can let them know that I sent you with an affiliate link down below. And thanks. All right, so next up, I want to cover some of the exciting games that are playable on Linux and SteamOS. And first up, if you've watched my podcast, then you've probably heard me talk about Domekeeper to no end. It has become an obsession of mine and that of my co-hosts as well. And, well, this week, Domekeeper developer BippinBits revealed a trailer for Domekeeper's long-awaited multiplayer update, and this has me particularly excited. Now, I know that I'm on record as a vocal critic of online multiplayer games, but here's why. Playing games with your friends is inherently fun. So if you play a game that is inherently not fun, but with your friends, then it kind of just becomes fun, right? Looking at you, Fortnite. Domekeeper is currently a single-player game, and yet it's fun to its core. Adding multiplayer here can only enhance the experience and the enjoyment of the game, and it feels like a natural extension of the gameplay to add multiplayer. So, to say that I am excited for Domekeeper's multiplayer update would be an understatement. To be able to play the game with Hightech and James? I mean, that's just gonna be a bonus, right? Make sure you get subscribed to the Off the Console channel so that you don't miss our livestream when we will be playing this together whenever it comes out. There's no release date yet. And you can also pick up Domekeeper with the link in the pinned comment below to help support this show. Next up, one of my most highly anticipated games of the year, Gears of War Reloaded, has hit, and reports are that it works shockingly well on Steam Deck. Now, I haven't played the game yet, as I have been crazy busy over the last week, but it's on my playlist, and I'll probably be giving it a play here sometime soon on stream or something. Now, if you haven't been following it, Gears Reloaded is a remake of the original Gears of War for the Xbox 360. This isn't the first time that it has hit PC, but this is the first time the title has been available on Steam. This is a new version of the game that includes all of the DLC of the original, including the cosmetics, the extra campaign chapter, multiplayer maps, and more. But this build also includes new 4K textures, upgraded lighting, high-resolution shadows, and remastered assets. Plus, it supports HDR, ultra-wide monitors, variable refresh rates, FSR, and DLSS, and it also has a benchmarking utility. Now, I'm really stoked for Gears of War Reloaded, and it's seemingly working well on the deck, but if you're playing on desktop Linux, you're probably going to have to update your launch parameter to read Steam Deck equals 1% command percent. It's kind of trivial to do, but once you do that, you should now have no issues launching and playing the game. Now, the question is, what do you think? I'd love to know your thoughts on Dome Keeper's multiplayer update or Gears of War Reloaded. Let me know in the comments. And while you're down there, why not like that smash button? It's the best way to tell YouTube you want to see more videos just like this. And did you know that I release a new video every Friday? Get subscribed so you don't miss those. All right, so I want to introduce a new segment into this show. I'm going to call it Emulation Station, maybe. And that's because, for me at least, as a Linux gamer of some 15 plus years, emulation has been a cornerstone and continues to be, like, the linchpin of core gaming on Linux, right? For this update, I want to touch on the hotly anticipated 86-box version 5.0. This is an absolutely massive upgrade for PC emulation. Now, if this is your first time hearing about 86-box, you might be thinking, well, hold on, why do I need to emulate my PC? I already have a PC sitting right here in front of me. And that's a great question. The fact is, there is a long, storied, and complicated history of PC hardware and software abstractions for that matter. And while, yes, you can probably run some legacy titles on, you know, your desktop, either on Windows 11 or on Linux through Proton, the fact is you're going to have a better experience running period-accurate hardware or emulating period-accurate hardware. And that's where 86-box comes in. It's able to emulate old hardware in highly accurate ways. It not only convincingly emulates the 8086 CPUs of the earliest IBM PCs, but it can reliably emulate Pentium CPUs, Voodoo GPUs, Sound Blaster cards, and even the Roland MT32 MIDI interface. Now, this emulator is not for the faint of heart. Given the breadth of its capabilities, it's somewhat of a bear to configure on your own if you're not intimately familiar with late 80s and early 90s hardware. But it is also a rewarding and even nostalgic process, and it can even enable some truly amazing gaming experiences. And I will mention that there are some third-party apps that are meant to handle setting it up if you want a more plug-and-play experience. Now, with all that said, this version 5.0 update is huge. They've done a lot to improve the entire experience, but some of the important changes are they've improved mouse input and display output. These are enormous upgrades here, and they provide a much smoother experience overall. The OpenGL 3 render is now capable of a convincing CRT emulation, as well as other shader effects. And there's a ton more here too. You can actually check out the release notes with the link in the description, and you can also let me know what retro titles you're gonna try on 86-box. All right, KDE Plasma just had a big update with version 6.5, and there are a few things here worth noting. First of all, there's the KISS, or KDE Initial System Setup Utility. It's a standout feature here in this release. Many KDE users won't experience this given that they have already set up a user account, keyboard layout, and other system level details during the installation process. Quote, but what if someone else ran the installer? Say the company you bought the computer from, or the last person who wiped the machine before giving or selling it to you. In this case, no user accounts have been set up, or something needs to do that. Now you're able to factory reset your machine and give it to someone else, and their setup experience will be a breeze. Pun definitely intended. There are other updates here too, including scrollable panels when they contain too many entries, improved tone mapping for HDR content, better accessibility of the system settings shortcut page, and more. You can check the release notes in the description for more details. Next up, we have the new Framework Laptop 16, which now includes the RTX 5080 with 8GB of GDDR7 VRAM and the Ryzen AI 300 series CPUs. This upgrade in the hardware boasts a, quote, 30 to 40% increase in gaming frame rates over their original RX 7700S graphics module. That's a respectable increase for sure. It's available for pre-order right now, and the module is fully compatible with the original Framework Laptop 16. This is very awesome stuff, and this scrappy startup is somehow embarrassing the hell out of the bigger players. I absolutely love my Framework 14 laptop for its sustainability, modularity, repairability, and customizability, so I love to give them a shout out here because what they're doing is awesome. And finally, let's end the episode with an update for Catchy OS. The August 2025 release includes changes aimed at stability, a new subdomain that allows users to inspect the provenance of software packages, a new window manager, and more. First, there's packages.catchyos.org, and it's a dashboard that users can use to gain insight into the source of software used on their system. Users can sort by architecture, repository, package name, and update time, along with other criteria. Many of the CatchyOS packages come from Arch Linux, Catchy's upstream. Other packages are built by the CatchyOS devs, and finally, a few are sourced from the AUR. This gives end users confidence and peace of mind while using CatchyOS. Then there are the stability updates, and there are two primary changes here. First of all, to increase compatibility with GPUs, Catchy is now shipping with the Linux Catchy LTS or long-term support kernel. When you boot the installation media, the LTS kernel will be used. This should help reduce the graphics-related issues on startup. Then, once Catchy is installed, it will still use the latest stable kernel by default. However, the LTS kernel is installed as a fallback in case users encounter issues. Finally, there's a new window manager available to use. It's Neary WM. Now, honestly, I had never heard of Neary before this, but after researching a bit, I found it's a tiling window manager, and it looks pretty neat. There's other updates as well. You can use the link below to check out the August update for Catchy OS. And guys, with that, we've had a pretty crazy week of Linux gaming news. I want to thank my members on Patreon, on YouTube, and my Ghost blog for their continued support. They make the show a reality. If you'd like to see your name listed over here along with these fine folks, you can use the links below to make a monthly contribution. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next week.